Hello everybody, my name is Dr. Talia Marcheggiani. I'm a naturopathic doctor. Today I'm going to talk about hot and cold contrast showers. As naturopathic doctors, one of our modalities is hydrotherapy. Hydrotherapy comes from the naturopathic medicine's roots. We're using hot and cold water to make changes to circulation, hormonal functioning, and immune functioning. I'm going to talk about some of the science behind hot and cold contrast showers. This is something I recommend to my patients to increase their immune activation, decrease autoimmunity, improve mood and hormonal functioning, as well as increase circulation. And there's some evidence that it might help with weight loss as well. So firstly, things like exercise and hot and cold therapies induce a little bit of stress. There's two kinds of stress. Distress, which is sort of like that chronic cortisol-fueled stress that a lot of people come in with in a state of burnout that's causing things like inflammation and mental emotional illness and autoimmune issues and dysbiosis. And then there's something called eustress, which is more like exercise, cold therapy, short, small bursts of stress that actually upregulate proteins and genes in our body to combat stress. Then these genes are involved in DNA repair, in increased antioxidant synthesis, and the antioxidants that our body makes are far more powerful than the ones that you're going to get from food or supplements. So by upregulating these genes, we can protect ourselves from cancer, neurodegenerative disease, and other chronic diseases. It's really powerful stuff. This is called a hormetic response, so hormesis, where small stressors mount bigger responses by the body than is needed to deal with those stressors, and overall we're better off. There's sort of this net beneficial effect. This is one of the proposed mechanisms for some of the antioxidants or flavonoids in green leafy vegetables. It's not that they provide us with antioxidants, it's that they encourage our body to make antioxidants in response to the small toxic load that they present to us. So there's some evidence that getting short bursts or longer bursts of cold, very cold, will increase a hormone called norepinephrine. Norepinephrine is involved in depression and mood. Norepinephrine is a catecholamine, and it increases the sympathetic nervous system, which is that fight or flight nervous system. When boosted in small amounts, it can actually elevate mood. And so a lot of antidepressant medications also induce or inhibit the reuptake of norepinephrine. So these are called SNRIs, and they include things like venlafaxine and Cymbalta. So there's some evidence that norepinephrine increases 2 to 3 times after only 20 seconds of immersion in cold water. There's a connection between norepinephrine lowering pain and inflammation and increasing metabolism. And there's some anecdotal evidence, and one study at least was done to show that cold immersion therapy actually decrease symptoms of depression. There's also these things called heat shock proteins and cold shock proteins. So for example, one is called RBM3, which is a cold shock protein. And these proteins can actually help us they can help increase longevity, and they can actually help decrease incidences of neurodegenerative diseases and neurodegeneration, so something like Alzheimer's disease or Parkinson's disease, which can help us with health longevity, so staying healthier into our later years. We know that inflammation is one of the drivers of the aging process, so probably the primary driver of the aging process and one of the main factors in chronic debilitating disease. And especially in my focus, mental health, there's more and more research coming out that inflammation is in low levels of inflammation in the brain is the main cause of mental health conditions such as depression, anxiety, bipolar disorder, OCD, ADHD. There's these low levels of inflammation that contribute to the symptoms of low mood. And so by increasing norepinephrine through small bursts of cold and increasing those cold shock proteins, we're actually able to combat these mental health conditions. But norepinephrine decreases inflammation by decreasing a cytokine called TNF-alpha that is known to increase inflammation in the body and in the brain. TNF-alpha can cross the blood-brain barrier, and it can inhibit serotonin synthesis, and it can actually also increase neuroinflammation, causing symptoms of mental health disorders. There are some studies that cryotherapy for rheumatoid arthritis actually decreased pain significantly. And there's also some studies that being in cold water, that cold shock can actually increase the immune system activation. So it's good to increase our immune system activation if our immune cells are behaving properly. If our immune cells are attacking ourselves, then we want to decrease the immune response. But having higher levels of lymphocytes, especially cytotoxic T lymphocytes that are involved in killing cancer cells, is a very positive thing. And that's been shown to increase in people that underwent cryotherapy or really acute short exposure to intense cold. There's also an ability to lose weight when exposed to cold over the long term. And there's a man called Ray Cronies who lost over 80 pounds by just habitually exposing himself to mildly cold temperatures. One of the mechanisms for this weight loss is through non-shivering thermogenesis, in which the cells in the mitochondria uncouple proteins that make energy, and they dedicate all of our stored fat energy into making heat. So it's kind of like biking and cutting your bike chain. So you're not moving forward, but you're generating energy and you're generating heat. So our body will do this when it's slightly cold so that it can increase in heat. So our body is always striving to maintain a constant temperature between 1 or 2 degrees. This process is regulated by norepinephrine, which rises acutely as soon as we're exposed to just a few seconds of cold. And this can be like 40 to 50 degree water. And then I already mentioned that short cold exposure can increase production of antioxidants. Antioxidants, our mitochondria are constantly creating reactive oxygen species and reactive nitrogen species. And this is just a product of normal cell metabolism. These become toxic though and damage DNA if our body doesn't also produce antioxidants to clear out those reactive oxygen species and reactive nitrogen species. And so the cold induces a little bit of a stress that increases our metabolism, that increases the reactive oxygen and nitrogen species in our mitochondria. And therefore our body is incited to upregulate the enzymes that create those powerful antioxidants that I talked about that are far more powerful than the ones that you can get from food, vegetables, fruits, vitamin C supplement. And a couple of these enzymes are glutathione reductase and superoxide dismutase, which are very, very powerful to our cells. There's some evidence that hot and cold therapy can increase muscle mass, can increase muscular strength and aerobic endurance. So this is great for athletes post-workout to lower inflammation and improve muscle regenesis. And then it could also increase something called mitochondrial biogenesis, which is the production or the replication of more mitochondria in the tissues, especially the muscle tissue. So our body will increase the mitochondria content, the mitochondrial mass in muscle tissue under certain conditions. And these conditions are mainly fasting, exercise, and hot and cold shock. So what I'll recommend to my patients, somebody who's suffering from low immunity, so they're getting frequent colds and flus, or maybe autoimmunity, or maybe just general inflammation and pain, brain fog, sluggishness, adrenal fatigue, that kind of sluggish lethargy from depression. So it's more of the sluggish depression. I'll recommend hot and cold showers. So what you do is in your shower, either during your shower, during your regular cleaning routine, or after your shower is done and you've already washed your hair and everything, you're going to turn the water on to a reasonably hot temperature, so not so hot that it's scalding. And you're going to leave that hot water on for 30 seconds to a minute. When that's done, you're going to turn the shower to as cold as you can tolerate. So with my patients, I often coach them to start with a lukewarm temperature before going whole hog into cold. And this is just to kind of coax the body into that stress response that we want. That short, quick stress response is going to do all those good things. Upregulate antioxidant production, increase norepinephrine, decrease inflammation, increase mitochondrial synthesis, burn fat. So you're going to try and make it as cold as possible for 20 to 30 seconds. And then you're going to cycle back and forth at least 5 to 10 times. Always end on cold, and then when you're done, towel off and keep warm. There's some evidence that doing this before bed can actually increase REM sleep and help you sleep more soundly without waking up in the middle of the night. And we all know that a good sound sleep is gonna set the tone for the next day and your energy for the next day. And then there's also some evidence that doing this in the morning can increase your energy and alertness throughout the day. So it's almost like the same practice at different times of day impacts our circadian rhythms differently and can give us more of what we want, either more profound sleep or more daytime energy. So that was hot and cold showers. My name is Dr. Talia Marcheggiani, and you can check out my website at taliand.com or contact me at connect@taliand.com. So a lot of this research came from Dr. Rhonda Patrick at foundmyfitness.com.